Hi, I'm Robin Whalley, welcome to Lenscraft. In today's video, I want to share three things with you that you may not know about Affinity Photo's Develop Persona. I'm guessing you won't know about them because most Affinity Photo users seem to overlook these. I'll start by opening a RAW file. Affinity Photo then automatically opens this in the Develop module. When you want to change the Affinity Photo preferences, you usually select the Preferences option. On a Mac, this is under the Affinity Photo menu, whilst in Windows, it's in the Edit menu. But when you look through these preferences, they don't seem to relate to any of the settings in the Develop module. Instead, you'll find the Develop module preferences in the Assistant, which is this icon. I think it's supposed to look a bit like a waiter. Click this and you'll find some important settings for the Develop module. If you've never seen these before, it's worth taking a little time out later to experiment with them. But what I want to show you is one that seems to raise questions quite often, and I can imagine it's affecting at least some of you watching this video. If you look at the RAW file preview on my screen, it looks reasonably well exposed without making any adjustments. That's because Affinity Photo is automatically applying a tone curve to the RAW file. This takes a lot of work out of developing the RAW file. You'll find the settings controlling this in the Assistant Preferences under the Tone Curve dropdown. Now watch what happens to the image when I change this to take no action. The image now appears flat, underexposed and lacking in contrast. And I'm guessing that a good percentage of people watching this video have RAW files that appear flat and underexposed. If that's you, check the Assistant options and you'll probably find the tone curve set to take no action. Now before you change it, I want you to realise that not applying a tone curve isn't necessarily a bad thing. All it means is that you have to work a little harder when you're developing your RAW files. Some of the adjustment sliders don't appear to respond as strongly when there isn't a tone curve. But the advantage of not setting a tone curve for some images seems to be that you can produce a more natural image. The next thing I want to talk about are the Affinity Photo color profiles. You'll find them in the Affinity Develop module at the bottom of the Basic panel, though you might know them by another name. These are often called color space. The color space controls the range of colors an image can use. For example, if you share a photo on the internet, you may use a small color space like sRGB. This then limits the range of colors to ones that most well-calibrated monitors can handle. If instead you use a large color space like Adobe RGB, there would be a good chance that lots of monitors and devices out there would have a problem displaying some of the colors. When they do encounter a color they can't display, what they do is replace it with something that's a very similar color that they can use. This can cause the image to look different on different screens. But when you're editing a photo using a small color space like sRGB, it restricts the range of colors in the image. This could mean that your image isn't as rich and vibrant as it might otherwise be. Instead, when you're editing a photo, it's better to use a wide color space like Adobe RGB or even Profoto RGB. Now, to select a color space, use the profile dropdown at the bottom. Now, I was going to tell you that this defaults to sRGB, but it seems to default to the last profile that you selected, sometimes at least, and I'm not really sure from the testing I've done. Now, I've also been testing this, and when I don't select a color profile, Affinity Photo seems to embed sRGB as the default. So for the best photo editing results, be sure to consistently select a color profile like Profoto RGB before clicking the Develop button. You can always change it when you come to export an image later. Now, if any of you are NIC users watching this, I want to show you something else. Whilst the NIC collection is compatible with Affinity Photo, you can still produce a strange color shift when using NIC Viveza. Now, I do want to stress this isn't the same problem that we used to see when Viveza was changing colors if you were working with a 16-bit image. This is a bit different. Let me show you an example by launching NIC Viveza with this image. Notice how different it appears compared to the preview. The color shift makes editing in the NIC Viveza app almost impossible. but notice what happens when I click the OK button to apply any changes. Once I'm back in Affinity Photo, everything looks fine and we don't see a problem. The reason for the colour shift seems to be that Viveza doesn't like working with Profoto RGB colour profile. If you use Adobe RGB, you do still get a similar colour shift, but it's not quite as severe. And when you use sRGB, you don't see any problem. Now, I haven't tested it with any of the other colour profiles, so you may find ones that work better. Okay, let's go back to the Develop Persona by opening a RAW file again, because I want to show you one other thing. When you're editing a RAW file in the Develop Persona, you may have some adjustments that you always want to apply. So an example of this might be, if you're sharpening an image and applying noise reduction settings, they're probably going to be based on your camera and its ISO setting. This is where you could use a Develop Module preset to speed up the processing. Each of the studio panels in the Develop Module that we use for editing has a preset dropdown at the top, and it's something that a lot of people just simply overlook. I'll demonstrate how they work by applying some sharpening to this image as well as some noise reduction. I can then click the preset dropdown to select the option to add new preset. Let's call the new preset Default XT3 ISO 160. Now, whenever I'm editing a Fuji XT3 image that I shot at ISO 160, I can just apply this preset to get the sharpening and noise reduction. This provides a good starting point for my sharpening and noise reduction, and in a lot of cases, I won't need to make further adjustments. And you can create different presets for each of the studio panels. Now, I hope today that you've found at least something that will help you. If you have, please take a moment to share it with others. And if you have any tips of your own, please share them in the comments below. I'm Robin Whalley, you've been watching Lenscraft. I'll see you next week for another video.